Okay, perfect. So we have about 10 of us in the room right now. Pardon the noise you hear from my side. There's construction going on all sides of my house. Apologize for that. Since we're just 10 of us, I think some of us, or at least I don't need to introduce myself, could we just very quickly, maybe in like 2 minutes, tell us who you are and where you're from so that we have a little bit of context to this discussion. So from the participant list, I will just call out the names and then maybe that's the most efficient way of going about it. Georgia, would you like to start with yourself?
Sure, very briefly. So my name is Georgia Rambelli. I'm the head of the IUC coordination unit based here in Brussels.
Thank you. We have Deshpat Lama. Could you kindly introduce yourself? Okay, I guess we would wait for Mr. Deshpat Lama to introduce in a bit. We have Ms. Divya.
Everyone, this is Divya Sharma. I am Executive Director of Climate Group in India. Very happy to be here. Hi, Soumya.
Hi, Divya. Thank you. We have Camilla Christensen Roy, the UD.
Yes, hi. I'm Camilla Christensen Roy. I'm working at the delegation, EU delegation here in New Delhi. I work on the sustainable urban. The partnership on smart and sustainable urbanization between the EU and India. And I work with the partnership on water as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Rai, for joining us today. We have someone, a municipal commissioner, I would believe, a municipal commissioner from.
Good afternoon. I'm H.K. Chitri. I'm Municipal Commissioner of Gangtok, Sikkim.
Hello, good afternoon, sir. A warm welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Naval. Okay, Mr. Neelab. I guess they're unable to speak right now. Mr.
Good morning, good afternoon. I'm Panagiotis Karamanos, responsible for IUC India project.
Thank you, Panagiotis. And Ms. Paolo.
Good morning, good afternoon to everybody. I work for the European Commission Joint Research Centre and I'm supporting the India IUC program with technical expertise with my team. Thank you.
Sorry, my mic was on mute, but I am the team leader for the India-EU Urban Partnership and also a senior expert on the IUC.
Perfect. Thank you, Mr. Neelab. Thanks a lot. So, an excellent group. Anybody else who was unable to introduce themselves? Okay, kindly feel free to chop in, and we'd like to hear from you. I think we'll start with the discussion in the interest of time. If I could go to the next slide, please. I don't have control of the slides, I believe. Okay, so the intent of this discussion was basically to get a sense of what is it that you're how is it that you're working in your city towards climate mitigation? What are the processes and where do you stand currently? Mainly focusing on the institutional governance processes a bit. I know several of us on the group here are not from the cities. We have Mr. Chatri representing Gangtok and I think one other gentleman, but several of us are development partners. So I think from your side also, it would be useful to hear on what you are typically seeing in the cities and how is it that any of that could change or how could we make it more efficient or what is required in that sense? Very specific questions for the discussion. How is your city working to align your emission reduction targets to national goals, if at all? And how often do you review your target and measure if your city is on track? So how often do you do an emissions inventory and see whether you're able to meet your targets? The next slide, please. So that's specifically on the targets. If we can have the next slide. Yeah, on the climate action plans, where is it, what is your priority? So where is it that you're seeing, what are those critical sectors that you have identified, and what specific actions if taken would have the most impact within your city? And from an energy access, inclusion, just transition perspective, what are your city's plans to move towards green recovery and focusing more on sustainable energy sources? What are your plans for increasing sustainable energy in the energy mix, and how are you going about that? So these are the three heads under which we have questions. And let's go to the first one, which is on the targets. And we would like to hear from all of you who are in this group. So if we can go one slide above, please, on the targets. Yeah, thank you. So how is your city working to align your reduction targets to national goals? And how often are you measuring your targets? So could we hear from all of you, either your experience in working with the cities or from the city itself? If I may, I would like to request Mr. Chetri to kindly indicate to us how Gangtok is taking this forward.
Mr. Chetri, you can unmute yourself by clicking on the red icon with the little mic that you see beside your name.
Okay, while we wait for Mr. Chetri to respond, could I ask other colleagues who are on call who would like to speak to this topic? Or speak to this particular question, set of questions.
If I may provide a comment, Sumi, on this, I'm not the most knowledgeable person about this process, but I think that what is happening in India over the last few months or maybe even years is that the cities are first trying to understand what are their own emissions based on the data that they have, which is not always the case that they have good data. And then they try to see, as you are correctly asking here, how to align these with the national goals. And I think that important processes during this phase is for them to use some specific tools. Now, earlier today, NIUA presented the a Smart City Climate Assessment Framework, which very nicely brings in together a lot of data from more than 100 cities in this case. So I think this is an evolving process. I think my understanding is that not all cities or many cities are still not, let's say, aligned with the national targets, whatever these are, but all of them are in the process of trying to see how to do that.
Right, Panagiotis, thank you. Thank you for that. I think the big difference that we're seeing from the European perspective and what's happening in India is, I think, more the Indian cities are focusing more on where do I stand today and what is possible based on where I stand today and based on a climate action plan, rather than having a political ambition or a political target up front and, you know, then trying to dovetail to that. Anybody else who would like to speak to this, please?
Well,
yes, sorry, please go ahead.
Thank you, Kamila. Well, like Panagiotis, I'm also not an expert on this particular area, but in general, I have, let's say, two comments here. You showed in your slide earlier about the 18 Indian cities, right? And I'm thinking that these cities, of course, it's great, and you know, we have that momentum started and we have initiated the process. But if I just look at the 80-20 rule, in some sense, you know, in a country like India, it's really the big cities, if we can capture them and bring them on board to drive these targets, you would really capture a lot of impact through these bigger cities. And it's not to say that, you know, tier two or tier three cities are not important. They are extremely important as well. But I think also getting the big cities on board will give us these, let's say, in some sense a low-hanging fruit, right, in terms of the numbers and the impact measurement. That's one comment. And the other comment that I have is that when, let's say, for example, we have a municipal commissioner who is responsible to achieve these targets, my question really to them is how much resource or how much time do they have to actually spearhead these initiatives, such as you know, driving these targets, because we know that they are all inundated with the day-to-day activities and citizen or just taking care of the city, especially given the pandemic situation. So how much resources do they have to actually implement these initiatives? And then secondly, how much importance it is given at their city state policy level, whether they are able to meet or they are unable to meet the targets. The significance or the importance of this should also be recognized at a sort of higher level within the administration. So I think these are some of the issues, and of course I understand that it's a dynamic process, and if you look at India, the process has just started in some sense. So I'm quite sure it will pick up. But these are some of the thoughts that come to mind off the cuff.
Thank you, Neelab. All very, very relevant points. I think those of us who started way back in the 2000s thought of the big city
right. I think that there might be some issue with the connection. Then maybe Paolo, I will also ask to give us your help as to support the co-moderation while Sumia gets back online. But I understand that Divya had some comments. Divya, would you like to take the floor?
Thanks, Georgia. So I was just adding to what Neelab was saying, two, three points. The first point is that when we are assigning the responsibility of targets to GHG emission reduction targets to municipal corporation or the urban local body, we will have to be cognizant of the fact that they work under specific mandates, and not all sectors that are GHG producing GHG emissions would be under the purview of these municipal corporations working. The one task that could be done perhaps over here is to look at cities preparing a climate charter of sort, where they kind of spell out their ambitions about GHG emission reduction and try to bring up a forum which involves other departments, parastatal, state level department, onto this particular platform where they can work collectively towards city GHG emission reductions and have a target set for, say, 10 years beyond and something like that. Or it could match with the national targets. I think that sort of thing is missing at the moment. I'm hopeful that the Climate Smart Cities initiative by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs that Mahesh just talked about would give that window to have those indicators and assessment frameworks to cities to even measure their emissions. But the problem really lies around the mandates at the moment.
Thank you very much. I don't know if Sumia is back with us.
Yes, Georgia, I apologize, everybody.
No worries.
I had a drop in the power and then the net disconnected.
We had a very interesting conversation with Divya that was talking about the importance of looking into cities that are already preparing their own plans, but also to double check what the mandates are, because of course some of the sectors might not be under the competence, and how important it will be to bring together all of the other actors that are working in developing these targets jointly. And the idea was also to, of course, align with the national targets. And maybe then following up with that, Sumia, and I'll give you the floor. My question will be, one of the, of course, at the basis of the GCOM, as you know, The idea is the cities will be able to commit to a target that is at least as ambitious as the NDCs of the country. So I think maybe that is indeed something that has to be taken into account when developing this plan. But nonetheless, I was wondering if, as of now, even the most advanced cities, and I know that there are a lot of cities in India that are doing a lot of work, is it been easier for them to, you know, having a lot of experience to develop such targets, or is it still a challenge even for the most ambitious ones?
Miss, is that a question to Miss Divya?
To everyone, also to you.
I can speak about it, and Nilab pointed out the question around big cities. I think there are different challenges that big cities face here, and smaller cities have different challenges. So, like, for example, smaller cities would not have the capacity and technical know-how to start this process in the first place, while on the other hand, where big cities have the resources and connections or networks to you know, initiatives such as this one. And for example, Italy is working with so many cities. So usually bigger cities have that access, but the problem again comes down to my previous point on mandates and bringing together different departments, state level, parastatals to the fore so that one can collectively work towards GHG emission reduction. So there are several mitigation sectors that a city would entail, but the municipal corporation as such or the urban local body as such cannot look at emission reduction data at their level because they don't have that kind of access to other departments working, you know what I mean. So that is, you know, primary. And these are two different things that one has to balance and look at. How do we facilitate the smaller cities to start earlier than their bigger counterparts, and also bigger cities to bring together more stakeholders onto one platform. And I was suggesting, Soumya, when you were not here, about perhaps looking at a charter of sorts by cities. And it could be instituted in any of the departments. It could be urban local body. It could be state level urban development department, which kind of guides this process.
Right, Divya. That's true. Especially with the big cities, like you were saying, they have the access to the resources, they have the access to the network, they have the access to the technical capacity. But what is extremely challenging there is the institutionalization and the governance process. Somehow, that becomes the largest bottleneck there, irrespective of all of this. And with the smaller cities, they're more fleet-footed. So if the leadership exists and they have access to resources, they're more fleet-footed. So they are able to convene. You know, the one big thing that the Climate Smart Cities Assessment Framework has done for the cities is somehow given them, I wouldn't go so far as to call it a mandate, but they've given them the authority in a certain way to kind of convene these different stakeholder groups. So to convene the parastatals, to get information from the DISCOMs, to get information from the the TWAD boards, the external agencies, the state level agencies, which are actually custodians of this information that you need for the emissions inventory, like you rightly said. So the CSCAF has kind of given them that framework within which they can actually ask for this information and kind of get this information together. Between the first round of the CSCAF and the second round, we've seen significant improvement. This has improved by the states stepping up. So the urban development departments are kind of facilitating some of this, where they are actually writing at the state level to some of these larger entities. And for example, the oil companies and, you know, to the power sector, where they are facilitating the information down to the local authorities. So some of that has been happening as well. So I think this is a very dynamic space that we are in right now. And I think it would be good if we can take some of these lessons post the CSCAF version 2 and, you know, kind of develop this guideline. It doesn't work the same way in every state. For example, Tamil Nadu is more centralized. Gujarat, the cities are able to convene on their own, whereas cities in Tamil Nadu are unable to yet. So it's very different state by state, but we can come up with guidance with NIUA addressing some of these, you know, different typologies that we are seeing, if we may call them that. Ms. Camilla had a point.
Thanks. Earlier. Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Yeah, what I really thought is that that's important to build upon the work going on already. Like we heard now very briefly on city of Rajkot, but it could be interesting to understand from their side more clearly the way they are working, and they have worked for quite a number of years. There's, I believe, also other projects, other cities under the IUC working on climate action plans, of course, under the DECOM. And we heard from Gujarat, there's eight cities. I believe also the city of Gangtok. So I think that spending time and listening to the cities who are working on this could be very good to learn more. I think also it's important that to keep in mind also that cities in India, they also have a rather other urgent matters, like ensuring water for its citizens, water supply, sanitation. I mean, there's a number of what services which really need to be in place. So, but it doesn't mean that one should not look at the climate action, because it can actually link over to the wastewater sector and the energy sector, the transport sector. But my main message was probably to learn more from the cities already working on the, for example, climate action plan. Thank you.
Can I come in? I have one maybe comment or a point here. Is the budget that a commissioner has at his disposal with respect to GHG or even climate adaptation measures that he can implement? So one is doing the let's say the exercise of data collection and monitoring and analyzing. But what if the data leads to a particular project that needs to be implemented in the city? Do they then have the funds or the mandate to or easily access those funds, right? Because otherwise then it becomes an exercise which doesn't really meet the end objective. I mean, we have all the data, but if the data needs to be implemented, then there is a project that needs to be put. So, for example, I live in Copenhagen. So in 2011, there was a massive cloud burst here where there was huge amount of flooding. And basically, for those of you who know a bit about Europe, they have a lot of commercial activities in the basement level. So all the basements were flooded and there was a huge economic impact. So what they have done now is for the next 30 years, they have planned adaptation measures for, based on the flood patterns and the flood forecasting throughout the city, which they will implement over the next 30 years. Now, that has come from the city of Copenhagen because they see that as a revenue loss. If they don't implement $30 billion over the next 30 years, 30 billion kroner, sorry, over the next 30 years, they will not be able to get that kind of revenue in case of such unprecedented events. So that's how it functions here. But I'm not sure whether that same kind of mandate and, luxury in some sense is available to commissioners and even mayors in India. Hopefully the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act will. And I can see there's a lot of devolution happening, which I will talk a bit tomorrow in the session that we have tomorrow as well. I can see that it's on its way, but maybe the pace has to be hastened a bit, in my opinion.
Thank you, Neelab. Thank you for that. I don't know if we have the time, but I have a slide actually where we have exactly what is the budget that a city requires for the next 5 years. And how much from the municipal budget are those climate action plans going to be funded? which of those climate actions have actually to be funded through public-private partnerships, and which of those are then dovetailed also for co-financing through the Amrut and Smart Cities missions. So there is this thinking within the cities, and this has been happening, where a five-year climate action plan, I right now have a list of about six cities which are actually taking a five-year action plan, breaking it down into municipal budgets, and seeing what is coming from the municipal budgets, and seeing what it is that can go to the larger missions and the public-private partnerships. This is possible. There is a mandate, and this is, it has started, and it is actually working quite well. We will be coming up with a monitoring report verification report on that, both from a mitigation of actions point of view, as well as from the finance devolution for that. And from where is it that they got the climate finance? Just speaking to what Ms. Camilla had said, Ms. Camilla, this is something that was started looking at the process, the governance process, the institutionalization process, where cities have climate core teams, which are made up of multi-departmental departmental heads from the different sectors. And they have nominated stakeholder committees. The stakeholder committees are actually nominated and convened by the municipal council through a political notification, where it is this committee that the cities go back to periodically, be it for their climate action plan or for their smart city mission implementation or whatever it is. So there are cities which are actually doing that. Surat does that. Coimbatore does that. Rajkot does that. So does Udaipur, Siliguri. All these cities do have this kind of a governance process. And we will come up, I think we'll work with the IOC team as well, and maybe a little bit of a pan-India story of how this is happening. Any other points?
Yeah, if I may connect now, yes, thank you. I want to inform you that as GSC, we have been working with the city of Vadodara, helping them to formulate the climate action plan, starting for the data collection. Unfortunately, the COVID crisis has not facilitated our activity there, because we the city is very busy with other priorities, as was already stated. So we hope to resume very soon working with them. And also, we would have done some meeting mission to the city to know the people, to help them, you know, in a real face-to-face collaboration. But it was in 2020 was impossible. So we will continue with the city, and in the next phase of the IUC, whatever is called the new phase starting next year, the GRC will continue to support India, and also perhaps supporting other specific cities. In addition, we're also developing a guidebook, which will illustrate basically the CRF in more details for India with some Indian experts. And we are very keen when we have a draft to consult the Indian cities and also the local stakeholders like ICLE and other organizations. That's all from my side. Thank you very much for the very interesting discussion we had in this breakout session so far. Bye.
Thank you, Mr. Paolo. Very interesting, and look forward to those results and how we can support that process. Any specific inputs on the energy access plan? We haven't spoken too much about that. The energy access poverty pillar is something that the GCOM is looking at. Have you seen any specific actions to this effect? Or how cities are using this opportunity right now of this entire pandemic, trying to look at a green recovery, or how are they furthering their sustainable energy plans, and how are they scaling them up? Any interesting thoughts?
We are closing in 15 seconds, so before we conclude this, I want to thank you all. Maybe just very, very quickly, in Europe, when we talk about energy pillar, energy access pillar, mostly energy poverty. So that's also one of the filters that we are using to understand that. I'm not sure how that is relevant for India and poverty.